really is more beautiful, simplicity or engraved elegance? When it comes to the violin pegs of Stradivarius and Guarnerius, it's completely up to us, because almost every last one has been replaced. Even the engraved pegs on Stradivari's Messiah were made by Guillaume of Paris. And as original as Guarnieri's Violino Piccolo is, it has replacement pegs also, as does Stradivari's Clapisson Poche, whose pegs just happened to be made by Jacques Francais's father, Emily. We've been told that most of these pegs were fashioned after the originals, yet even the Medici's tenor viola's pegs are up for debate, since it has two different styles, and neither seems to rise to the occasion. Unlike so many other artistic items that affect the appearance of a Stradivarius or Guarnerius violin, the pegs truly are in a different category. Because regardless of how well an instrument is loved, how long it's been safely tucked away, all that it takes is for one person, one single afternoon during the past 300 years, to change the original pegs forever. Even the great connoisseurs have changed their opinions and nonchalantly swapped out the originals. Most have agreed, though, at least during my lifetime, that the finest golden period Stradivaris literally beg for the finest of engraved pegs, while Guarnieri's most gothic instruments demand simplicity. For all the others, what matters most of all is the customer. My favorite example is Jascha Heifetz. It seemed like every time that I saw his Guarnerius, it had different pegs on it, or at least a different combination of pegs. I don't know if he collected leftover engraved pegs along the way, or if it just didn't matter. But even better, I like to imagine that since his Del Gesu is one of the most flavorful of all, with a scroll carved by Giuseppe's dying father and the varnish applied by his wife Caterina, maybe the mismatch is actually a perfect match. Most violinists, and for that matter, most violin makers, have no idea what it takes to make a truly fine set of engraved pegs. Yet some do, and they, like Guillaume, have to decide which of Stradivari's and Guarnieri's masterpieces are worthy to be adorned with them. Their words, not mine. One of the great advantages that Stradivarius had over Guarnieri was that his violin shop was fabulous. It was wonderful, and it had every resource necessary to give his wealthy and sometimes royal customers everything that they could possibly dream of or desire.
That was wonderful.
Oh, thank you.
It may have been a while, but
yes,
yeah. That was good.
Thank you.
How much cleaning would you like? I know you do a bit of fiddling and some classical.
Yeah, I mean,
some fiddlers like it to still look a little grubby.
I don't need it to look dirty. I just am terrible about cleaning.
Okay. Well, wonderful. This is the place.
and my poor peg, but yes. That's just cosmetics. Okay. So.
Well, it is and it isn't. I'll tell you what. Shall I make you a new one?
That would be wonderful if you can.
Okay, I can.
That'd be great. Thank you so much.
All right, that may take a couple days extra, so.
Sure.
The reason so few violin makers ever make pegs is that it requires completely different tools, different skills, and an entirely different mindset. Without these, it can take longer to make a fine set of engraved pegs than it takes to make a violin. And, just like violin making, fashioning the finest pegs has its secrets. Stradivarius had the finest lathe that money could buy. But he would have loved this one more, because the more perfect a peg is turned, the more beautiful the hand carving becomes later on. As mentioned in other videos, most people limit themselves by what they think were the limitations of the old masters. Yet Stradivarius not only had the finest tools, he had, at almost any given time, 4 apprentices, including his sons, who helped him rough everything out. His philosophy being the same as any great sculptor. The greatest art is not created with worn-out hands. Guarnerius, sadly, worked most of his life in poverty, with just the basics. And it's believed that over half of his instruments didn't survive past 1790, because while the bodies and scrolls of his instruments were true masterpieces of art and acoustics, once a thick layer of rosin was caked on the famous Cremonese varnish, and his instruments needed a sound post adjustment or a major repair, most people just couldn't see past his rough pegs and rustic cases. It always reminds me of Vincent van Gogh, who couldn't afford to frame his own paintings. And if it weren't for his brother Theo and his sister-in-law Joanna, who knows how much of his art would have been lost also. This particular peg happens to be a modification of an old discontinued model that I happen to have, which means that I can skip turning a new one and go straight to the engraving. I may not be as wealthy as Stradivarius, yet he and Guarnerius both would be jealous of Bertha. I've been asked if Bertha could carve violins, and yes, she could, but they wouldn't be master instruments, because each piece of wood needs to be carved differently. But pegs are different. I've used many drafting programs, but AutoCAD is still my favorite after using it 41 years. An optical comparator is a great tool for this. G-code programs may look intimidating, but they are wonderful because they can tell a machine exactly where to go and how fast to move. I wrote this program manually, but they can also be generated automatically if the direction of the grain doesn't matter. All of the rough engraving is done with a 60-degree single-point cutting tool. In the time of Stradivarius, most of this process was accomplished by taking a few extra days to design and engrave the first peg, then making more pegs of the same design by using a follower or pantograph, with an apprentice sawing away on a bowstring mandrel. But regardless of how a peg is roughed out, all of the final shaping and smoothing is done with traditional carving tools to add character and for a smooth quality finish that complements the instrument. The image of Stradivarius roughing out his finest violin pegs using apprentices and bowstring mandrels, or myself today in one of the back chambers of the violin shop, as mentioned in the book Two Trees, with a machine, may seem foreign to the traditional images of master violin making, and to some, maybe even heresy. And that's why this part of the process has traditionally remained a secret.